May I come in, sir?
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. Thank you, sir.
Which area
you are staying, Motibagh? Sir, I'm staying in Old Motibagh, which has recently been renamed as Northwest Motibagh, sir.
Okay, that is in front of New Motibagh?
Indeed, sir.
Huh?
Indeed, sir.
There
are
some dispensaries there.
Indeed, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
Some renovation has been done there?
Sir, I think it is being planned for after East Kidwai Nagar renovation is complete. So currently there is no renovation going on, sir.
Your father is which batch?
Sir, he's a officer of the 1993 batch, sir.
Recently, DGP CID.
In ADGP CID, sir.
Tell me how the public perception about police in Haryana. My perception is very bad. In general,
indeed.
How is the perception public?
Sir, I think the public perception mirrors your perception. It is mostly on the negative side. Haryana police is seen as a very brash, crude, violent force. However, sir, I believe that while this is true, because there are very often cases of police brutality and custodial violence, I think that on the whole, Haryana police is a force for good, sir.
That way, law and order is okay. I don't find much problem there. But the behavior, because first thing is behavior, how you behave. Police is forced to protect you. But at the scene of police itself, people are scared. You don't know what will happen. And the same culture is being carried to even Delhi also. Because maximum number of police officers at the lower ranks are from Haryana.
Indeed, sir.
So, what do you think? What is required in this perception change?
Sir, I think several steps will need to be taken for this perception to change. Firstly, sir, I think there is a requirement of intense training within the police, which has to be taken up by officers of the highest levels from the highest to the lowest levels. Secondly, sir, I think in line with the Prakash Singh judgment requirements, a police complaints authority should be formed, where citizens can directly file complaints and action can be taken. Sir, currently the police complaints authority has not been formed in either Haryana or Delhi. Actually, sir, I don't think it has been formed in any state in India as of today. So certainly, sir, there is a lot to be done and steps need to be taken soon, sir.
Training thing also is not being taken
care of. Sir, training, I think, is done regularly. Sir, I can only speak, I'm aware only of about Haryana police, sir, where training is an annual affair. Similarly, sir, to specifically answer in the case of Haryana, sir, Dial 112 is a new program which has been started by the police, where even police harassment complaints can also be filed and within an action on which will be taken at the earliest possible time, sir.
What is Advocates Act?
Sir, the Advocates Act is a Act of Parliament passed in 1961, which regulates the profession of law in India. It also makes the classification between an advocate on record, and a senior advocate, sir.
Define advocate as
per that. Sir, to the best of my knowledge, anybody registered with the Bar Council of India having cleared the prescribed examination is an advocate, sir.
Okay. And advocates can also be appointed as judges, you would have seen that.
Indeed, sir.
In yesterday's recommendation, what is... something new, there is a precedence of that. What is that?
Sir, the name of additional Solicitor General, Senior Advocate Mr. P.S. Narasimhan has been suggested, sir. If he is appointed, I think he will be the 6th or the 7th direct appointee from the Bar to the Supreme Court, sir.
And
he
will be CDI also?
Indeed, sir. If all the appointments take place, he will be the Chief Justice after Justice Nagaratna, who will be the first woman Chief Justice of India, sir.
And what is some similarities there about her and another judge, brother judge?
Indeed, sir. Her father was also a Chief Justice of India, and Justice Chandrachud's father was also a Chief Justice of India.
And what is special about him?
Sir, he's the longest serving Chief Justice of India for 7 years, from 1978 to 1985, sir.
The Supreme Court, in one of the judgments, they recommended deletion of Section 309.
Indeed, sir. I'm sorry, sir. I'm not able to recall the name of the judge.
Okay, what is the
section 309? Sir, it relates to attempt to suicide, sir. And the court had recommended strongly that it be decriminalized because criminalizing an attempt, an unsuccessful attempt, does not help anybody, further worsens the situations in which the individual is in. And
the person needs help, not punishment.
Indeed, sir.
That was Ramachandran's case.
I'm sorry, sir. I'm not able to recall the same.
That is S.C.
Sir, Aruna Schoenberg, indeed, sir. I'm sorry.
Aruna Ramachandra.
Schoenberg.
Indeed, sir. She was a nurse in Bombay hospitals.
Okay. We have two types of law courses now. One is integrated course, which you did. Other is the Delhi University.
Indeed.
Which one is better?
Sir, I think the integrated course is better because law is a multidisciplinary subject in a sense where deep knowledge of various other subjects such as history, sociology, basic English also, sir, I think are all required, and an integrated course can convey all of those skills better, sir.
But they also come after that, they pass the graduation and after that they do this course?
So certainly the 3-year course also has its merits. It allows people to be able to specialize in a subject entirely before they get into law. But sir, purely looking from the point of view of law and legal services, I think an all-encompassing course where various skills such as patient listening, communication, an idea of India's history, our social economic condition can be conveyed is perhaps better suited to our condition as compared to the 3-year LLB course, sir.
Still, there is a lot of demand of this Delhi campus.
Yes, sir.
Anmol.
Sir.
How old is this course? You look a little healthier right now.
Indeed, sir. I have put on a lot of weight during the corona time, sir.
The photo looks a little old.
Yes.
The Prime Minister was proposing August 14th should be considered as a horrors of partition in modern history. What do you think about that?
Sir, I think that it's a step in the right direction. I think it does several things. Firstly, it shows state recognition of the horrors that were conducted during partition. Secondly, sir, it allows families which are affected during partition to be able to participate in a national movement or a national day and provides solace. And thirdly, sir, days of this nature in other countries in the world, such as Holocaust Memorial Day or the day of the ending of the or the day of remembering apartheid crimes in South Africa, have allowed societies to move past and to reconcile these differences. And sir, I think that the Partition Horrors Remembrance Day will do a very similar task in India, sir.
During the second wave of COVID, there was various intervention by the judiciary.
Indeed, sir.
Some are considered as an act of activism, some are overreach. Can you tell me what is activism and what is overreach in this?
So in the specific COVID? Sir, I think the actions of the judiciary which changed the distribution of the vaccines scheme, the 50-25-25 scheme, sir, in my view, I think was judicial activism, but because the vaccination system required a uniform distribution and procurement system. However, sir, the Supreme Court orders on which state should get how much oxygen, I thought, sir, was a instance of judicial overreach.
Now, there are some controversies associated with it. Can you elaborate on this?
Indeed, sir. Sir, the current Delhi police chief, there are two main controversies which are associated. First, sir, that the Central Civil Service rules were amended in order to allow for an officer who had about a month to go before his retirement to be appointed as Delhi Police Commissioner. And secondly, sir, the fact that the officer who has been appointed is not from the Agmod cadre has also caused some feeling of disaffection within the offices of the Agmod cadre, sir.
Okay. Various tribunals heads are lying empty. The government has not appointed. Is there a pattern in this, or why is the government doing something?
Sir, the appointments in the tribunals have been pending since 2017, and since then the appointments have hardly been made. This is primarily because there has been a tussle between the executive and the judiciary on what should be the rules which govern the conditions of appointment and service for members of the tribunals. As a result of which, sir, first we saw these rules being brought in by a finance act, which was struck down by the court, then brought in as rules, which was again struck down, then as an ordinance, which was struck down just last month in the case of Madras Bar Association. And now, sir, it has been now the similar reforms have been brought in through the Tribunal Reforms Act, which was passed about a week ago, sir.
Under what circumstances can ordinance be used? And how is it being used now?
Sir, an ordinance can be used in order to pass any legislation which the union government or the state government believe is important or has public importance while the legislature is not in session. Sir, I believe that the ordinance in recent times, the use of ordinances in recent times has gotten better and has reduced as opposed to, say, the previous decade. And sir, I think that ordinances have been introduced mostly for economic reform-led measures as opposed to, say, measures which had a much larger social or political impact in the past decade, sir.
What do you read in nonfiction?
Sir, I mostly like reading biographies and autobiographies.
Can you tell me some biographies that you've read recently?
Sir, the last book that I read was called Method in Madness. It's an autobiography of Secretary Parmeswaran Iyer. And it writes about his journey as an insider in the IAS, then taking a VRS, then joining at the lateral entry level as secretary for Swachh Bharat program. So I quite liked that book. And right before that, sir, I had read Before Memory Fades, which is the autobiography of senior advocate Fali Nariman, sir.
Last question. What is your biggest weakness?
Sir, I think I have a tendency to procrastinate. And I think that makes me lazy at best and really inefficient at worst. And so this is something that I try and fight every day, sir.
So what are you doing about it? How are you trying to fix this?
So firstly, I think the very fact that it is at the center of my cognizance and in my mind, I think it makes me take small steps in my daily life. Secondly, sir, I have a feedback group in a sense of my closest friends, my younger brother and my mother, who tell me if they see these tendencies coming back into me. And thirdly, sir, I try and write down, I try and maintain a record of what I do every day. And sir, as such, it tells me if I'm going into a slump. And so, yes, sir, these are mainly the things which I do, sir.
So you're a lawyer.
Sir.
Or an LLB graduate, what are the
differences? Sir, I would say I'm a lawyer. However, the main difference being that, sir, once one is registered with the bar council of a state or of a state high court, they can call themselves lawyer in that they can practice. However, any LLB, anyone who's given the LLB exams is a LLB graduate, sir.
So, have you registered in some bar council?
Indeed, sir. I've done my provisional registration with the Bar Council of Delhi.
Okay. So tell me, why not? You're a very articulate person. You argue very well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
But why not become a very good lawyer? Why civil services?
Sir, I think there are several reasons why I decided to appear for this examination and not go into law. So first is that I do not want to be bounded by the financial capability of the person I'm helping to determine how much I want to help him. And I think that's a central part of the legal business. Secondly, sir, I believe that the civil services offers a proximity to change or a proximity to development which no other job may allow for. There are various ways to be able to do social development, but the proximity that the civil services offers, I think it puts it in a separate league. And thirdly, sir, I think that there is no other job which can provide the job satisfaction and the job quality that the civil services provide, sir.
Why not you can do pro bono litigation and helping
poor
people?
Certainly, sir. But through my experience of interning with lawyers who are in the pro bono litigation period, a lot of time is often spent in trying to find cases in order to subsidize their pro bono litigation or to find sponsors amongst big lawyers so that they can continue their pro bono litigation. And sir, I believe that the impact that pro bono lawyers have is much lesser in comparison with the civil servants. On both these counts, sir, I think civil service fares better, sir.
Can you tell me the overall problems in the judicial system and in
sir, I would classify the problems of the judicial system under three headings, sir. First relates to efficiency. There are about 4 crore cases pending in the Indian judicial system, which the Niti Aayog estimates at the current rate will take over 300 years to clear, sir. And I think as a result, this makes the judicial system highly inefficient, has problems even on the ease of doing business because our contract implementation is very low and so on and so forth. Secondly, sir, I would say is a question of transparency. The fact that judges refuse to be covered by RTI and any proceedings against them happen behind closed doors, as was the case in Justice Gogoi, as well as Justice Ramanna's complaints. Both, sir, I think undermine public confidence in the courts on the whole. And I think that there is a requirement for both these issues to be looked at. And thirdly, sir, the heading of accountability. I think, sir, thirdly being the heading of transparency, sir. If I may rephrase, the third heading being of independence. Sir, I think that since the NJAC debacle and then the back and forth on appointments to the tribunals, there have been some doubts which have crept into the mind of people about the sanctity of the institution and the sanctity of appointments. And sir, I believe that there is requirement of a national consultation on the judicial appointments process so that a statutory or a proper concrete manner of doing the same can be introduced, sir.
Can you tell me some more reasons for the high vacancy in
case? Sir, I would list 3 or 4 reasons. Firstly, sir, is the high vacancy number. At the district level, the sanctioned strength in all of India is about 24,000 judges, whereas currently only 16 to 17,000 judges are in function or hold office. Secondly, sir, is a high number of vacations. For a district judge sits in court only for about 240 days, a high court judge for about 215 days, and a Supreme Court judge only for about 190 days. And sir, as such, I believe that with such a great backlog, this low number of days is a main reason for the inefficiency. And lastly, sir, I would say that very few technological advancements are being leveraged at the district level. For instance, case management systems, systems which allow for e-filing of evidence and affidavits, etc. There is very, very low adoption of that, which is why the process, which is already burdened, continues to move at a sluggish pace.
And what about certain judges are also reluctant to make judgments, to give final judgments? Is that also?
Indeed, sir. What happens very often is that the court will reserve its order for the judgment, and then the judgment will be passed at a much later stage. And sir, it is to counter this problem itself that Justice Malimath Committee had suggested that at the end of every judgment, the judges should be, it should be made compulsory for the judges to write the date of hearings ending and the date on which the judgment is delivered, so that this specific problem can be dealt with, sir.
Judiciary has given the reason that it affects their independence. What is your opinion?
So firstly, I think it takes us away from a non-statutory and sort of grey area method of appointment in the collegium to a properly structured manner. Secondly, sir, I think that the equivalence drawn between the judiciary and the executive in appointing judges is a good step because it shows a cordial cooperative environment between the two institutions of state. And thirdly, sir, I think that it also allows us to fight or at least make public the issue of nepotism that we face in judicial appointments. I think NJAC would have brought in many newer judges or first generation lawyers, as opposed to the current system where a handful of families across India, about 300 to 400 judicial families, are the ones which contribute most of our lawyers, sir. And so for these three reasons, I am and was in favor of the NJAC, sir.
You have a hobby of cricket also. Do you play cricket or watch cricket?
Sir, I play and watch cricket both, sir.
Recently, Kohli's captaincy has been under scandal. What is your opinion on Kohli's captaincy?
Sir, I personally am... I have my criticisms of his captaincy because certainly... it seems that the individual is put in front of the team very often under his captaincy. And we saw that there was a change in the manner the team was behaving on field in Australia after he came back. So he came back from a big loss in Adelaide to win the test matches and then defeat them at Gabba. So, sir, I believe that criticism is accurate. However, on the whole, I am in favor of his captaincy. I believe that he has brought in a much better fitness culture, a much better work culture to the team. And sir, I think also to have the world's best batsman as your captain definitely adds to the morale of the team, sir.
But he has not been performing recently.
Sir, yes, the last 15-16 months have been a little hard for his batting style. But sir, still, I believe that his inherent talent is still present and that it will help us on a rainy day, sir.
So your name, you are happy with this? And more name?
Sir, I think it really raises the expectations from me, but otherwise I'm happy, sir.
Regarding Kohli, you are just saying for 15-16 months he has not performed well. Now, 15-16 months is a long period. 1 or 2 months one can take it. I don't know, I personally feel it's not that his captaincy is bad, his selection of team is bad. You know what I mean? The number of batsmen and the bowler team chooses. At times he made the mistake. And trying to find all rounder in everybody the game. So anyway, that's the your institute is in Dwarka or where is it?
Indeed, sir. It's in Sector 14, Dwarka.
This is a new thing. Our usual law faculty is, of course, Delhi, Morris Minder.
Indeed, sir.
Then we are the South Campus. And this is in Dwarka. The
yes.
Whole campus has come up.
Sir, our university is not part of Delhi University.
Yeah,
indeed, sir. But
yeah,
it's in
the Dwarka. Law school thing.
Yes, sir.
Can you name other law schools starting from Bangalore?
Sir, NLS Bangalore, NALSAR Hyderabad. NUJS in Calcutta, NLU in Jodhpur, in Bhopal. So I think, sir, there are about 16 national law schools in India now. Yes, sir.
You didn't try Bangalore?
Sir, I wrote the CLAT. I was being offered NALSAR Hyderabad. I missed Bangalore by about 5-6 ranks, sir.
That's okay. Let's talk about ICJ. What is ICJ?
Sir, the International Court of Justice. It is the primary judicial body under the United Nations, and it is seated at The Hague in the Netherlands, sir.
Now, how effective are they?
Sir, I would say that the ICJ has been effective in trying to resolve disputes that have come before it. However, because ICJ can exercise jurisdiction only over those disputes which are brought in by both the countries which submit to its jurisdiction, its efficiency is reduced because very often countries do not want to go in front of the ICJ itself.
How many judges are there in the ICJ?
So there are 15 permanent judges in the ICJ, sir.
Really? Permanent 15?
Yes, sir.
Any Indian there at the moment?
So I think Justice Dalveer Bhandari is still on the court, sir, currently serving.
We have one case there. I mean, in Pakistan. What's his name?
Sir, Kulbhushan Jadhav, sir,
yeah.
Whose judgment... Sir, the judgment was delivered by the ICJ in 2019. However, sir, before the judgment could be enforced, Kulbhushan Jadhav passed away in a Pakistani prison, sir. And as such, the judgment has been rendered infructuous, sir. I'm sorry, sir. Then I must be confusing.
You are confusing.
I'm extremely sorry, sir. I'm extremely sorry, sir.
Pakistan, are they honoring the ICJ judgment?
Sir, the judgment had two parts. The first part was that Kulbhushan Jadhav will be allowed consular access from India. And second would be that under a free judicial system, the trial of his case will take place. So the second part has not been acted upon in any way. There is no retrial, no independent procedure to check for his guilt. The first part, however, sir, Pakistan has complied. India, there was some... No, sir. This is an inherent limitation in the ICJ and its jurisdiction that the ICJ cannot compel countries to comply with its judgments in its entirety. And sir, as such, there is not too much that can be done from a legal, international law standpoint, sir.
So that way, you take Supreme Court judgment also on Kaveri issue, for example. They give some judgment, Karnataka, then in Bangladesh.
Indeed, sir. However, sir, there is a lot more power to sanction or the power to punish for not complying with the Supreme Court's judgment, as opposed to say in the case of ICJ, where countries can just blatantly say that they do not agree with the judgment and not apply them.
What punishment? Take this particular instance of Kaveri issue. Karnataka, have they been punished in any form?
No, sir. However, sir, I believe, sir, what I meant to say is that at least on the books or by the statute, there is a power to initiate contempt proceedings against the Chief Secretary of Karnataka if the judgment is not complied with.
Reality, what is happening? Okay, now what is this competition law? Here, competition law.
Sir, the competition law is a branch of law which has been introduced basically to make sure that there is no market distortion either by abuse of dominance position or by entering into anti-competitive agreements, sir.
You think it's really needed?
Sir, I believe that in a market economy system, competition law is required in order to make sure that there is a level playing field for all players and that nobody, because of their presence in the market, is able to create artificial barriers for entry or to distort the market prices by using the great amount of financial power that they have, sir.
Now, let's talk at the international level. Again, we have an agency to ensure there is a level playing field. Which agency is that? The trade part of it.
So the World Trade Organization.
Are they succeeding in any way?
Sir, I would say that the World Trade Organization has been successful to some extent in being able to apply the most favored nation standard and the non-discriminatory standard amongst the countries. However, sir, with countries such as China, which use currency manipulation and dumping very often, the effectiveness of the WTO has been reduced greatly, sir.
Yeah, almost all countries have these anti-dumping issues.
Indeed,
sir. US, India, of course, almost every country. So you think it's all that effective, WTO? Anyway, compulsory licensing. What is this compulsory licensing issue?
So compulsory licensing is when the government, the state, is empowered to allow any other manufacturer, is allowed to override the patent protection of an individual and allow and give out license for the production of a patented product to non-patent holders, sir. It is permitted under the Indian Patents Act as well, sir.
Okay. And last question. Major recommendation on the 15th Finance Commission.
Sir, so firstly, sir, on vertical devolution, the Finance Commission recommended that 41% of the funds be devolved to the states. This was 1% lower than what the 14th Finance Commission had recommended. Secondly, sir, the Finance Commission has laid down 5 different types of grants under the grants and aid which can be given to states. The highest amount has been given to revenue deficit grants. Thirdly, sir, the grants which have been recommended for the local bodies, the third tier of governance, are the highest till now. Overall, rupees 4.8 lakh crore have been recommended over a period of 5 years. And fourthly, sir, the terms of reference contain specific provisions to comment on defense and internal security bill that the union government has to pay. So a separate grant has been made to that extent also for modernization of defense and internal security infrastructure for rupees 2 lakh crore, sir.
And how about the population? How are they accounting?
Sir, the census of 2011 has been used for the first time in the calculation of the Finance Commission. To allay the fears of the southern states, a new performance-based indicator of demographic performance was introduced, which was given a weightage of 12.5%, sir.
And for the other states, southern states, there's something more?
Sir, to the best...
And forests?
Sir, forests in the 14th Finance Commission were given a weightage of, sir, I think 10%, which has increased to 15% in the 15th Finance Commission.